Inside this room, all of my dreams become realities, and some of my realities become dreams.
What in the wide, wide world of sports is going on here?
Alive! It's alive! It's alive!
You are listening to The Wilder Ride, getting wilder by the minute. Here are your hosts, Alan Sanders and Walt Murray.
Hey, everyone, and welcome back to The Wilder Ride, getting wilder by the minute, a podcast that celebrates the films of Gene Wilder 1 minute at a time. And for our second season, we are diving into Blazing Saddles 1, Drive Me Off This Picture Minute at a Time. I'm your host. I'm Alan Sanders.
I am your co-host, Walt Murray.
And we are so proud to have joining us again, Chris Korman, son of Harvey Korman. Welcome back, Chris. Thanks for being here.
Oh, welcome. Well, thank you guys for having me back. I love doing this. This is fun.
Oh, and a big happy hump day out there. If you're catching us on the live release date, this is a Wednesday, Igor's favorite day of the week. What hump? We make sure on our Facebook listeners page, every Wednesday we do a shout out to all of our new followers on the listeners page, and it's all dedicated to Igor.
One thing we're going to have to do at the end of this season is talk about the great lines that continue to live on from these movies, because that is just one of them that I laugh at every week.
With the what hump?
Yep. What hump?
What hump?
Wet hump.
Well, let me tell you something. I would be driving along in the car of my father, and we would recite History of the World Part 1. And I mean, my fries. And he starts grabbing for my fries. I said, you had yours. These are mine. And he's like, what is that from? I said, that's you in the carriage with Andre Fusinas from History of the World Part 1. He said, you don't remember your own dialogue?
Well, I was going to ask you about that because, you know, when we had Burton Gilliam in with us, sometimes it took a little prompting, but he remembers all those lines from Blazing Saddles. I don't know if he could do that from all of his movies, but he remembers those lines from Blazing Saddles like he was just learning them today. How was your dad with that? Were there movies that stood out to him or certain lines that stood out to him, or did he just have total recall?
I was shocked once in a while. I would throw something out to him from a movie that he doesn't remember doing. He'll go, what is that from? I said, you said it with Mary Tyler Moore and Robert Wagner and Don't Just Stand There. You don't remember? Because I don't remember what I had for lunch last week. Give me a break. I mean, we'll do the old ones. It's good to be the king.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like there's certain lines that you use in reference to a interpersonal experience in your life. And I'll just look at my phone and go, it's good to be the king.
Well, you know what's funny is I've got a background in theater and I've done a lot of shows. In fact, I've done a couple of shows twice. And if you asked me to give you some lines, I'd have to go back to the script because it's like once I'm done with that show, I've moved on to the next one. It's almost like purge the file, make room for the next one.
So, Chris, were there lines that either your friends or other fans would expect your dad to come up with when they saw him or met him?
I'll tell you what, really, and this is a Blazing Saddles reference, and if he'll tell you, I think he said it in the Back in the Saddle video, the one thing that he would get when he's driving down the street or in a mall or in a coffee shop, it's Hedley. Now it's Hedley.
I got to imagine that's
the
one that
shut out
all the time.
In the middle of traffic, in the middle of Wilshire on Sunset, it's Hedley. Now it's Hedley.
I think the one that I always would remember, had I ever had the opportunity to meet him, I'd always want him to do the go do the voodoo that you do so well.
Oh, yes.
Now go do that voodoo that you do so well.
The one that gets me is the one where he slaps Marilyn Conn in the dressing room, and he has to recite every despicable person in a row. And
The list of mugs, pugs, thugs, nitwits, halfwits, dimwits.
If you ask my dad if he had to do that again, he said the only one that was tougher than that was when he and Buddy Hackett had to recite Who's On First in the Bud Abbott movie.
Oh, yeah, I bet that
because
would be
a it's a rhythm. If Slim interrupts him or coughs or burps or something happens, he has to start all over again. So it's a rhythm thing. And once you get started and the ball goes rolling down the hill, if you stop him or Malin should cough or Slim says something or a boom shot comes in or whatever, then my dad has to start all over again. So my dad says, I had to know it cold.
Oh, wow. So he did have it completely memorized.
He did, because he did classical training in Chicago. There's an old play called Little Me that Neil Simon wrote for Sid Caesar. It's like eight characters. And my dad did it in summer stock for like 6 or 8 months. It's eight characters. Martin Short won the Tony for it. You had to have your blood flowing to do one character, let alone eight.
Yeah.
But because my father did summer stock, and you guys know this better than anyone, if you're doing summer stock, you're doing one show after another, after another, another. So you had to learn your lines, but you had to know where the jokes are. But you had to be off script within 2 or 3 days because the director said, you can't be ready for production. You're still on script.
Right.
So my dad had to learn the art of in his head, picturing. Now, mind you, the production was different because they made cuts. They made like 7 or 8 cuts a day or whatever. By the time Friday came, the script was totally different. I used to call it 31 flavors of scripts because at the beginning of the week it was white. By the time it got to Friday, it was pew. It was like, because between the two shows of Burnett Show, it was taped live, but if things didn't work, they would cut. So you had to memorize, but as the week went on, you had to cut. But now in a movie, like Clayton Fellows, you're just doing a couple lines per scene, and they light and relight. So you only had to memorize as much for that day.
Right. And we know especially we've had some actors we've had on our show before, and having me been involved in some shows as well, it's amazing how little they actually shoot in a day, especially on a bigger budget picture. Maybe small indie flicks with a lot of dialogue would have a lot to shoot, but
yes.
It's amazing. You know, I remember someone said, if you can get through 2 pages of a script, you've done a lot in a day.
In the movie, Mel would do a scene with a paddle. That was probably the most frustrating day for my father because it was the first day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we talked about that earlier this week, and I like the fact that we can jump around a little bit with you, Chris, because normally we focus our guests on the minute at hand, but it's kind of fun to get some of these background moments. Well, let's go ahead and dive into this minute, because we continue.
Okay.
If you remember when we left yesterday, there was a riotous mob leaving into the streets of Burbank.
Yeah. Sorry.
And we get a shot of Hedley running off the lot, calling for a taxi, and we're going to end with him getting all cleaned up and saying, pain in the ass. I can't figure out what's going on. So let's go straight to the very beginning here, because we continue with the riotous. And at the very beginning of the minute here, one of the guys that is trying to make the left to go up Olive busts his butt and goes crashing to the ground.
I saw that.
Just totally tumbles right at the curb. Like, absolutely, like, knee plants down on the concrete.
Well, I love that you have the whole mob-a-lanche coming, streaming out of the gate there. I mean, that is really a great scene.
Well, what's amazing here is they obviously held traffic here, because we can see the don't walk, and there's a white car, two white cars on the line. Now, Walt, watch this. Right after the guy busts, we get a close-up. And as soon as we get a close up, where did the gray Beetle, Volkswagen Beetle, come from?
Rolling through.
Obviously, it wasn't at the line.
Yeah. Well, and if they shot this today, I mean, they'd have blocks around this closed off. So I wonder how that worked with this.
I'm pretty sure that they just went in between as much as they could and tried to keep traffic flowing.
It looks that way.
I don't know if they had cops there standing by. I think they just kind of tried to go, because nobody was, if you see, everybody stays to the
on the sidewalk,
studio lot side of the sidewalk. They're not running out. There's only one person that's going to cross the street, which will be coming up in a minute. We'll have Harvey Korman's character will be doing that. But we see they're still doing that split divide. And all of a sudden we get a shot of Hedley from behind. Now, he left first.
Right.
So what happened?
Well, the pie slowed him down.
Did the pie with the wind resistance in the face?
Not That's able? All I can figure.
He left first before anybody figured out what was going on, but the pie kept him from getting where he needed to go.
Well, if you've ever been hit in the face with a pie, it can really do
maybe
some.
Maybe he went the wrong way out the lot, and he realized, oh, wait, the exit's that way.
That's right.
Like you're supposed to know when you're running out of a studio with pie in your face. Like, you're supposed to know which way to go.
That's right.
I guess you could get a lot of that cream in your eye and stuff. You keep wiping it out.
It's terrible. And he may have had to run by his car real quick and grab something.
Now, right at second 7 into 8, as these people are still doing the divide, and we see the little employees sign above the entrance there, there is an older gentleman in a light, like a pale, almost powder blue, long sleeve sweater with gray pants. And he has this perplexed look as people are running by him. I have a story about that. According to the notes from the making of and behind the scenes, because this was an open sidewalk and they were trying to keep pedestrians at least from coming through the, when they were getting ready to roll, this guy was looking and trying to ask for directions from people. Like, we're shooting a movie here. Like, get him out of here. Get him out of the scene. And Mel's like on the other side of the street. Get him out of there. Get him out of there. And then the guy kept coming back and he goes, you know what? Just roll it and just go. We got to get the shot. And so this guy who watches Harvey Korman with pie in his face, he just, as Harvey comes to go through the crosswalk, he turns around to stare at him.
Yeah, he's just still staring at him.
And then he stares at the people running up the street like, did somebody just rob the place?
What the hell's going on here?
What's going on?
Well, here's how stupid I am.
Yeah, he's actually looking around trying to find someone to ask him what the hell is going on. And there's nobody at the stop.
Yeah, and nobody will even slow down to help him.
Right.
Right. And he's like, he's this old guy wearing glasses, and he turns around, and his arm is up, like, kind of like doing a Jack Benny thing. Like, what?
Yeah.
Why is Harvey Korman running out of a studio with pie in his face? And why am I sitting here watching this?
Well, I got to ask you a question. You were on a movie set. Well, Walt, this is for you in studio. When they say action, do you ever stop until you hear the word cut?
Oh, no, you keep on
rolling.
You keep on going because you have to assume, even the camera has to stop to a point. It's like, doing that when the directors start the scene, it takes a couple seconds for the camera to focus in. So you have to let the actor maybe move a little bit because you have to let the camera catch up with what's going on. So it's the same thing on the other end. If you stop what you're doing in the cut and then you have to finish that scene, the director doesn't have a chance to, you know, match that with another scene.
Right.
He has to start the other scene with, oh, wait a minute. You moved your arm that way that time. You have to do it again. If you just stop doing what you're doing, the director has to figure out, wait a minute, I have to now match that from another angle. So continue to do what you're doing. The director can always change and modify and make a cut. But if you just actually stop saying something in the middle of a cut, it throws the director off.
Well, you know? Thankfully, I didn't have to learn this the hard way, but somebody else did when I was on set. We were running in one scene where the ship was crashing into San Francisco. And when we're running along, as soon as one of the other extras got out of frame, he just stopped running. And so it was like a Three Stooges flick where everybody just goes crashing into him and it gets back on the frame. And so they had to reset everybody and redo it. And they said, when you're out of frame, keep moving.
You go until you hear the words cut.
That's exactly right.
They need to get enough coverage, like Chris was saying, to be able to give them the ability in the editing room to match those transitions.
That's right. And you really never know when the camera's on you.
Right.
You have to know if the camera's on you or not. You don't know. On a three camera thing, you know the light's on, right? But when you're doing a one camera thing, you can't assume, even if you're in the background, the camera's not picking you up.
Right. Now, if you look in the background, though, as Harvey Korman is calling the cab and it's pulling up to the curb, everybody that's an extra that went running up the sidewalk starts slowing down and coming to a stop, and they start milling around like, are we done? Do we have to go back to one? They didn't keep running up the block.
I know. They had tons.
They're all just standing
there.
They
could run another 200 yards.
They could keep going all the way up the sidewalk.
When I watched that movie, I don't see that because I always watched it on a smaller screen. So I never got a chance to see what Mel saw through the camera.
They're all doing a slow jog, and then they start to slow down. You see the chef.
Then they're just milling around.
You see the chef come to a stop. They all circle around him, and then all of a sudden somebody goes, well, keep running, and then they start to run again. Like, we're not supposed to stop. Oh, keep going.
And then Bart comes rolling out on a horse.
Well, before we jump that far, because we're looking at these guys, yes. Harvey Korman improvs a line here because this is not in the script.
No, it's not.
When he calls for the taxi and he shows up, and taxi is in the script.
Taxi!
But when he leans in, and we can't see him mouth it, so I don't know if this is something they did. He may have said it, and they decided to put it in the studio, like in ADR work after.
Mm-hmm.
But we hear him mutter,
drive me off this picture.
Yes, my dad improv that.
That's a great line, too.
It is wonderful. And when he gets in the back seat, he leans against the window by mistake and scrapes some of the pie onto the window. Right in the corner edge.
That part.
That's great.
Oh, my God.
This is why I do this.
I never saw that part.
Oh, yeah. If you look right in the corner of the window closest to the divider between the front and rear doors, as he leans in to go to get in the car and then he reaches out to grab the handle to pull the door closed, there's a big glop of pie of shaving, filling, whatever, frosting on the window.
That is awesome.
That is brilliant because, you know, I think every time I've watched it, Mel makes such a fast cut after he kind of gets in almost entirely into the cab or close to it. I think Mel cuts back to Clemon. So you really, unless the camera's really close, you miss those nuances of things.
No,
I never saw that.
This is definitely it. If you go back and watch right now, you could see this on your phone if you were to watch it. It's that clear because it is. The framing is so close that on Harvey really getting into the car, or Hedley getting in the car. You can't miss it. And once you see it, you'll never unsee it.
That is hilarious.
And Walt, you never saw that.
Nope. This is a first.
See, this is what I do. I ruin movies for people.
That's right.
I love it because it's almost, you know, and I don't know, it's at the Robert Chinese Theater. I don't know if it's really a bad Japanese movie. But I swear to God, when my dad says pain in the ass, it doesn't sound like it's lining up with what, because I think it's been edited so many times for that show with Robert Osborne, that, you know, they showed Blight and Sal so many times that they had made so many cuts that it looks like my father-in-law is pain in the ass and then he says it. It's like a really bad Japanese movie.
Well, we'll get there in just a second because it could also be the version, but I will say before we leave this shot, this was a city cab that came to get him, mm-hmm. So that's kind of cool. It's a old Ford. Did you ever have a car like that, Walt?
I never did, but my dad did. That was a good government issue.
I mean, wasn't that like every police car was like that same? It's
absolutely.
Like the Grand Marquis style.
Yeah.
Well, actually, Ford would be Crown Vic.
Yeah, it was before the Crown Vic. Yeah, this is
pre-Crown Vic.
This is kind of the government issue, standard stamp out cop car. Cops, taxis.
When my dad drives off and the cab goes out of frame and then Clevon is driving out, I swear I thought it was so weird to see, I think it was a VW Bug and a Datsun drive through. And I'm thinking, I wonder what these people are thinking. We're being chased by Clevon Little on a frickin' horse. maybe we should get out of the frickin' way. No, just keep on driving and get hit by a horse. I don't know. But I mean, it's like, where was the security in this movie? Seriously, I mean, if Mel really would have been smart, they would have made a deal with Warner Brothers and shoot this at the time of day where there was no traffic issues.
Well, you know what? At this point, it looks like they did hold for the horse. They didn't hold for the people.
Oh, thank God.
But it looks like because they knew the horse was going to kind of move out into the street. And actually, to be safe, when you got a horse that's normally used to being on softer soil, running on asphalt, you need different kind of horseshoes. Right. And they didn't want the horse to go sliding. So he has more a wider arc when he
God
comes
forbid.
Out.
Yes, God forbid we have Clevon Little sliding across Barham Boulevard in the afternoon in the middle of traffic. You know, how do you explain that to the, you know?
Yeah, to the insurance company that's now got to pay for it.
I wonder if they told the insurance company they were going to shoot this like this.
I doubt it.
Because it is such a short scene.
I would probably think they probably did not tell them the entire truth of what the scene was about. They said there was a horse involved. They just didn't say how it was involved. Because, I mean, that's just, to me, I mean, most of the time they just block off that part of a street and they shoot. But I don't know what the time of day that they shot that at. I would have to ask Mel if that was afternoon. It looked like afternoon.
It definitely looks afternoon. Or you know, with California, once the sun's up, you got such clear skies, it could be early morning shot or afternoon, just depending where the sun was in this particular angle. But it's a pretty well-lit shot, a typical outdoor lighting. It looks like they did park the cars to just sit there to make sure that nobody tried to cross the lot. They had four or five cars just all sitting there. And before the camera leaves frame, I don't know how many they had, but it looks like it goes all the way. And then we get that hard cut to now it's night. And we're outside of Grumman's Chinese Theater. So
I was about to ask you, doesn't that seem like a strange cut? Because it goes from day into night.
It does. It's like instantly.
How long the drive was it from Warner Brothers to Grumman's Chinese Theater in a parallel universe? Maybe, what, was it a 3 or 4 day drive? I mean, what the hell? I mean, really, come on. I mean,
Oh, I don't think it would take that long.
From Burbank to Grumman Sunny Cedar is not that long a drive.
No.
But how does it go from day to night that quickly?
Well, I think we have to just expect it. It's Mel Brooks. I mean, typically, when we want to give the passage of time, you usually will have like a slow fade to black and then come up so that way we get a sense of time. To do a quick cut like this usually means we're still in the same time, but obviously we can tell by the lighting, it's nighttime. You got the spotlights going, you've got the double marquees lit up, and oh, by the way, Walt, this always bugged me as a kid, and I finally figured out why when I became an adult. That blinking lights that say Blazing Saddles, that's actually matte painted and matched to move as quick as they could with the camera, but it's not perfect because they didn't have computer technology like we do, where you could paint out the box and match it as it moves. It wiggles a little bit. The film was originally going to be called Black Bart, and up until, you know, really the release of the film, and it came to Mel Brooks in a, you know, he was in the shower, he said, according to the story, and he went and told his wife, Anne Bancroft, he goes, what do you think about the movie? What if I called it Blazing Saddles? And she loved it, and so they changed it. But when they filmed this scene outside of Grumman's Chinese Theater, it was originally lit up to say Black Bart. And so they had to go back in and matte paint over and put Blazing Saddles as they're walking up. So that way, and if you look, when the camera starts to pan as the taxi pulls up, you can see that the lettering wiggles just a little bit because it doesn't match perfectly.
That's crazy.
Oh, my God.
I bet it's just a handful of movies over the years that have actually been named in production, you know, like had the name change in production. So, okay, so Harvey Korman is pulling up here. It's actually right now at this time of day, which I don't know, middle of the afternoon in Burbank, a 16-minute drive.
Oh, to get from the lot of MGM?
From
Warner Brothers.
From Warner Brothers to the Grumman's Chinese Theater. So, or whatever it's called.
Well, what's it called
now? TCL Chinese Theater.
Yeah, it's got some sponsor.
Well, how do you know it's 16 minutes? Did you time it or something? Or?
I'm looking on the map on my phone.
Yeah, you just plugged in a start and an end the two addresses, and it calculated for us. So with traffic right now at 3:30, well, as we're recording this, 3:50 LA time, it would take 16 minutes.
Yeah, 16-minute drive. So it got dark really fast.
God. Well, maybe it was an eclipse.
It might have been.
Well, you know, Harvey gets all cleaned up, so maybe he went somewhere first, and Bart's just been chasing around trying to find him.
It may have been
2 days. That's my question. Either the cab driver had a towel or paper napkins in the front and said, here, you want to wash off?
He just wiped it on the window.
Oh, yeah, he just wiped his face all over the window. That makes perfect sense. Like, I mean, I would ask for a towel or napkins or tissue or, because all of it is gone on the face. There's no reminiscences of whipped cream on his face when he gets out. It looks like he's completely clean. There's no whipped cream on his shirt. You notice that?
His costume is pristine.
That's what I don't get. Wouldn't there be whipped cream droppings?
There was when he first got into the cab. There was some on his black lapels. So he obviously had to stop somewhere.
Right, but when he says, drive me off this pistol, his face is off, his face in the cab. He says it, I guess they have a liquid in. Because my dad doesn't say it, you don't see him say it, you hear him say it. So he gets into the cab. So in the 16 minutes between Warner Brothers and Grumman's Chinese Theater, he had time to clean up? Really? Well, I don't guess that.
Maybe he ran through the Y.
maybe he ran through the Y.
It's fun to stay at the YMCA. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. They have everything fundamental.
Took a quick shower.
Yep. They had an extra outfit for him just in case in the trunk. Like, really? Okay. All right. Because most people who... I would have thought he would have come out of the cab. He'd still be cleaning off. Wouldn't you think that?
I don't. Maybe they stopped at the Quickie Mart and he needed a bite to eat or something.
Could have. I guess by then they had 7-Eleven.
Yeah. He stopped at the 7-Eleven, got a big gulp.
Yeah. With a Piggly Wiggly, with a soft drink and a hot dog, and picked up at LA Times while he was at it.
I mean, because he was off the picture at that point. I mean, he had the whole day to himself.
That's right. No schedule to keep.
All right. I got a serious question. If you're running away from the picture Blazing Saddles, Why in the hell do you drive to Grumman's Chinese Theater where Blazing Saddles is showing?
You want to see how it ends.
You want to see
how
I thought he wanted nothing to do with it.
Now that you say that, it makes me wonder. I mean, obviously, Mel has already broken the fourth wall with the breaking into the movie studio with my dad saying, driving out this picture. But to go to a theater playing Blazing Saddles, you've now completely gone off. Well, first, Tom Basie playing music in the desert, you lost it already.
Oh, yeah.
You've completely broken the fourth wall there.
It was really more of like a fourth curtain for this movie. It was not really a wall.
They broke the convention of time and place, location.
Yes.
Genre.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yes.
Everything
yeah.
you can possibly imagine.
But in all honesty, if you're trying to get away from the picture, why are you driving to the very movie you just left?
Well, maybe he thought he was going to see something else and just couldn't get away from it.
I got to ask Mel that. The next time I talk to him, this is really weird. Richard Pryor Jr., this good friend of mine, obviously his father co-wrote Blazing Saddles, wants to talk to Mel. So I've been calling Mel to get him connected with Richard Pryor Jr. because he has questions about his dad. So one of the things I was going to ask Mel is that exactly. Mel, if you took my father off the picture with driving me off this picture, why would you drive him to Grauman Chinese Theater and re-enter the movie again?
Right.
I don't know if Mel's going to be able to explain that. He's 96 years old. I don't think he wants to have to explain himself anymore.
No, you know what I think he'd say? I think he'd say exactly what Walt said. He wants to find out how it ends.
Right, but when he runs into the theater, and I swear to God, this is true. My dad's on Larry King Live, and one of Larry King's favorite lines in the whole movie is Raisinets.
Oh, yeah, we'll get to that tomorrow.
Okay, I have a story to tell you that, but
okay.
At that time.
Save that for tomorrow, because I also have a story that Mel Brooks talked about in a Playboy interview about inserting that line. But look at that, a tease for people to have to come back one more day.
Absolutely.
We're almost at the end of the movie. You might as well stick it out. Now, I can't see it on this size of screen, but I had somebody... I looked up some behind-the-scenes trivia, and apparently just under the Blazing Saddles marquee on that's closest to frame, the left side of the screen as you're looking at it, supposedly that poster there says actually Black Bart, because it was also dressed in the window, but it's so hard to see what it says that they didn't bother pulling that out, because obviously it's too late, you already shot it. So they replaced the marquee with the blinking Blazing Saddles, but they left a Black Bart poster up in the window before Harvey Korman just runs up to buy his ticket.
Oh my God, the things you guys have caught about this movie is amazing.
Oh, I love it.
I love it too. It makes me appreciate the movie all differently now.
So we see Hedley Lamarr get out of the cab, and he realizes there's a line, but he looks like this goes back to our question. It looks like he's trying to get away from whoever's chasing him. Like, he looks like he's really, I got to get through this line.
Right.
Well, yeah, but that begs the question, how long did it frickin' take him to get there when it's only a 16-minute drive and it's nighttime?
Is there a woman and a man stuck, a young man and a woman?
I think it's just all guys in the line.
Right. Oh, and he says, I think you dropped your ticket, and he pushes him out of the way.
Yeah, he says,
you dropped your beads.
It's like, this is that 70s kind of thing. You know, so he waits for there's three guys in line. There's a black guy and then two white guys. They all look kind of young.
Right.
The black guy just finishes getting his ticket. And as he does, and the next guy's walking up, Hedley pushes one guy to his right, one to his left. He goes, you dropped your beads, so he can get to the front of the window. Now, Walt, I've tried this before, and it usually gets me punched. It doesn't get me to the front of the window.
It doesn't
work this way.
I don't recommend.
Oh. Yeah, well.
One, please. Student?
Are you kidding?
No, you don't exactly look like it.
What did she say? Are you kidding me?
Yeah, she goes, are you kidding? So she doesn't give him the discount. If we want to know what...
in real life. He would have said the same thing in real life.
I'm sure. Because that's not it. That...
No, it might be asked if the person behind the window would not have recognized him. He would have said, oh, pain in the ass. Don't you ever watch television?
Well,
my father, who he is.
What's great is this is also additional stuff. They sort of improv. This was not in the script. The whole idea of getting, pushing his way to the front of the line, hearing the ticket woman, you know, reject his student ID and then calling her a pain in the ass. All that not in the script. But I do now know how late this showing is. Because if you look, there's an analog clock just inside the box office. and it shows just past 11 p.m.
Oh, my God. It's amazing you guys pick up on this stuff. I don't even remember that.
Well, when you freeze frame a lot to kind of take notes, you notice the thing with the clock. Yeah.
So it definitely has been a while since he ran out of the front of Warner Brothers.
Maybe they just went around the block a lot.
They must have.
He couldn't figure out where the movie theater was.
Ended up in the Hollywood Hills.
He took the long way.
Well, yes, it is. Well, we lived in Hollywood Hills, so I know that feeling.
Yeah, ran by the house real quick.
Yeah, right.
Let the dog out.
Yelp.
Continued the pursuit.
But, you know, I always ask, I want to ask my dad that. I never asked him. It's like, because you don't see her. You hear her say that. And then did Nell leave that whole moment in on purpose? Because you said it, it's not in the script. Did my dad improv that moment?
Well, it's definitely not in the script. Now, whether they worked it out to give us that little transition that we needed to get to the next scene here when he's walking in the theater and then coming back out.
Right.
The script itself does not at all mention anything about saying you dropped your beads or, you know, the whole ticket discount. So I don't know if it was improv in the sense of he just made it up, because obviously I'm sure he worked it out with Mel, or Mel worked it out with him, saying, okay, we're going to do something a little different here to just give us a little bit more of a transition as you buying your ticket. And as he's doing it, an old guy does come up behind him like he wants to go. So a lot of people wanted to come see the movie.
Well, I think it's funny the way Mel did it was a student pain in the ass. I think that's funnier than just making a quick cut and all of a sudden he's in the theater.
Right.
I mean, the idea of trying to use a student ID pass at my father's age, really? Would that keep pay? I don't think so. You know, the pain in the ass line is brilliant. I love that line.
It's a little hard to make out based on the angle, but it looks like the ticket prices, this is nice. I would love to go back to these movie theater prices for at least 1974. It looks like it says adults $2.50, and it looks like it says then children $1.25, and it looks like, I can't read what it says in the middle, but like it's $2.30. So I don't know if that's the matinee showing, you get a little bit of a break, but I'd love to pay $2.50 to go to the midnight showing. Of a premiere.
Who wouldn't?
Especially since I'm about to mortgage my house to go see Endgame tomorrow. Okay, so in 1974, the average movie ticket price. Do you want to take a guess?
The average across all of the country?
Mm-hmm.
$1.25.
$1.87.
Oh, I was a little low.
$1.87.
A little under $2?
That was the average. Goodness gracious.
By 1975, it was $2.05.
Wow, what a jump.
And then in 76, it was really out of control, $2.13.
Oh, I know. I mean, I have to break a 10 for two people.
You could go to the movies as a couple with a 5.
That's insane.
That's true. That is true.
So as he buys his ticket, and he yells that, or he says that line, that's the actual end of the scene here, where he says pain in the ass and starts to move past camera, pushing past us, and we're going to get a cut. And that's exactly where we end this minute, which is perfect to lead into tomorrow. Before we set the stage for what's coming tomorrow, Chris, you're our guest. We'll go to you first.
Yes.
Anything in this minute that we missed that you might have wanted to bring up, or anything that you wanted to go back over?
Well, this is just me, but it's always straight. I've been down to Korman Chinese Theater a lot of times when I've been there with my wife or my son, or just with myself. And I always wondered, how weird it would have been if I'd walked out and I'd still seen the imprint of my father's nose in Korman Chinese Theater. And they would have left it like that. So this is where Harvey left his face in Blazing Saddles. I thought that would have been apropos.
That would have been a great monument.
That would have been. And I never thought of asking Mel. It's like, because he falls in. I don't want to ruin it for another segment, but I always wanted to ask Mel. It's like, when he did that, obviously they have to clean him off and do it again. I said, they had to create an area where he could do that, but he obviously had to keep on doing it. And I'm thinking, after the second or third time, my dad probably said, enough is enough. How many times do I have to put my face in this shit? I mean, seriously. I mean, because you have to clean off. How many outfits of that, or did Mel get that in one take? These are all the questions I would like to ask Mel. I just don't want to bother him because he's 96 years old. The man should lay down and take a nap. But, you know, it's like, these are the type of questions that would make me want to ask him, because you can't do that scene again and again and again, because you'd have to have the same outfit, 10 or 15 of the same outfits. Because you do it wrong, you have to do it again. So I thought, oh my God, the idea of just seeing my father's nose in the imprint of Grumman Chinese Theater just makes me laugh. So every time I go to Grumman Chinese Theater, I'm going to go there and go, where's my dad's nose? Where's his face? Because it's just, it's so indebted in my brain, Grumman Chinese Theater, Blazing Saddles. It's just, you can't go to LA and not think of Blazing Saddles when you go to Grumman Chinese Theater. So that whole experience is embedded in my brain. So it's, the other part of the movie, and maybe we'll save this for another day, is I always thought it was funny that there are bulls in the lobby.
Well, we're going to get, that's tomorrow's episode.
We'll so get we definitely to it, but I always that. Thought that funny. I always thought that was funny.
All right. Well, anything in your minutes then for anything in your notes, sorry, for this minute?
I think we got it covered.
All right. The only thing I want to point to, because we're going to have a lot of script changes tomorrow. There was supposed to be a gag at the box office here where a quote, little old lady was trying to figure out how to make exact change of $2.50 to buy her movie ticket. And then Lamar's behind her going, dear Lord, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, because he's waiting because he thinks Cleavon's going to show up at any moment. So they changed it to give us that same sense that he wants to get to the head of the line quickly. Yeah. But rather than have a little old lady that gets shoved away, it's three dudes. And you feel a little bit better maybe about dudes being shoved out of the way instead of a little old lady.
You dropped your beads.
You dropped your beads.
Well, and we've already had an old lady assaulted. So I guess we got that covered.
Yeah, that was back in 1874. We're more civilized now.
That's right. That's right.
Anyway, we will get to a lot of script changes, though, tomorrow. The whole walking in the theater, the whole leaving your footprints, the whole checking about Hedy versus Hedley Lamarr is a whole lot that was completely changed when they decided to shoot the scene. All right. Well, before we wrap and give you a tease of what's coming up tomorrow, Chris, I know you have a show. Where can people hear your show and what's it called?
It's called TV Confidential. We celebrate performers from great sitcoms to present day television. It's a 45-minute over the phone radio program. Pulp culture. He's a pulp culture historian and author. He wrote the Perry Mason book and you'll find we have a subscription page on YouTube. It's called TV Confidential.
Excellent.
And it interviews the great icons of show business. We're hopefully going to have Mel and Carl Reiner on very soon.
Awesome. Well, considering at the time we're recording this, Carl Reiner is getting ready for that experiment where he's going to have Woody Harrelson and Jamie Foxx each play in the roles of two iconic sitcoms, All in the Family and The Jeffersons. So that should be interesting if you can get Carl Reiner in time for that to air live on TV later this year.
Well, we're trying. Carl's finishing his book. His wife. He's got more books out than I've read. I mean, the man just keeps on knocking out book after book after book. I mean, it just. I mean, the man is a. Oh my God, he's a treasure to be around. He's just so funny and wonderful.
Awesome.
Well, and folks, he has so much.
We definitely want to encourage you guys if you're out there to subscribe via YouTube or find it out there, TV Confidential, and check out those shows, Walt. If somebody wants to, we have a YouTube channel. Although someone was expecting video, it's a podcast.
Well, you know, I mean, I don't know why you'd want to look at us talk.
No, you don't want to look at us talking
for an hour. So we don't even want to do that. So, but you can find us there on YouTube at youtube.com/thewilderride. And every one of our episodes is out there on YouTube. So easy to share with your friends and family, easy to check out while you're at work or hopefully not in the car, but probably not.
Well, you can listen.
You can listen it's because okay there's listen. No video.
There's no video to watch.
So
well, the cool thing, and I know a lot of my friends that are in our age range or even their parents like YouTube, because once they subscribe, they get an email that says, hey, there's a new episode. And they just get a reminder. They click on the link in the email and they go watch it.
Which is great because then when we add some extra episodes or special announcements or whatever, interviews with people. In our off season, then you can catch those. And as my mom reminded us, you can say, Alexa, play the latest episode of The Wilder Ride. And here we go. So be sure and check us out on one of those two places. And then, you know, the normal places on Facebook and all the other great spots.
All right. And come back tomorrow. We have one more day with Chris Korman, son of Harvey Korman, who will be with us. And we will start off minute number 89, episode 89 with, look, Herman, I'm in Hedy Lamarr's shoes. And we hear Hedley. And then at the very end, we get Hedley getting shot in the doodads. And for that whole minute, you got
to
come.
That's one way to call it that.
Well, we'll see what happens tomorrow. You might change your mind. You might call it something else. But I'm trying to keep it safe. So right now, he gets shot in the jumblies. But we find out more about that by coming back tomorrow for this, The Wilder Ride.
The jumblies.
I don't know.
I was gonna say the family jewels, but I mean, if
you can say family jewels, the jumblies, well, the jewels, the doodads, well, the hoo ha. Yeah, that's the girl.
Well, for my personal thing, no offense, I'm not attacking anybody, but if Nolan had actually shot my father in the balls, I would have three less relatives and more money.
He's thinking, why did they use blanks?
You can say that. You can say that, and you can use it, because that's the best line I came up with all day, and, you know.
Oh, I will.
And the setting is true.
Yeah, he watches Hedley go by with the pie in his face, right. Basically. He's like, what right. the... And basically, yeah. They tried to get him out of there a couple of times, and then he just kept wandering into the shot. So Mel goes, well, let's just roll.
I know. It's
awesome.
It is funny. And you can hear me pretty good?
Yeah, I've okay. got you.
Yeah,
recording.
You're clear as a bell.
You're fine. I just have okay. to make sure I got Walt in the right spot, mouth-wise to the microphone. He's got this thing about putting, you know, like phallic objects too close to his lips.
Well. Well, I wanted to tell you guys, I gave you a great praise on my page.
Oh, sweet.
Oh, thank you.
And just saying that you guys are the Tim and Harvey of podcast.
I can take
and
that.
I said
I had such a blazing great time doing the podcast.
Excellent. Well, that is awesome. And we, again, appreciate you taking the time out of your schedule and with what you know to be part of this. That's well. Now, you know what? We're going to go ahead and keep talking for a minute because I have I'm the Radar O'Reilly of our radio station. I sense that the CSX rail line is about to come barreling through. So the last thing I want to do is start rolling when it's about to blow its horn. So we'll give it another minute or so.
Okay, so I have an answer to our...
Oh, my God, hold on. I had to do that all over again because I had my mic off for a second. Oh, my God, how much of this did I not have?
Yeah, I'm wondering. No. It got really quiet a little bit. Oh. Your voice kind of faded.
What's the last thing you remember me saying when it got faded?
You said there was something about it was originally supposed to be Black Bart.
Let me do that again. For certain, I cleared my throat and I turned my mic off and I forgot to turn it right back on. That's my bad. All right, so let me back up. I'm leaving a note to myself in the edit. Back up and try this again. I just don't want it to have to be in the background. People go, where the hell were you recording? Amtrak.
Train station.
We were doing show prep for season 3.
Exactly.